Okay, I think it's live on YouTube now. You can see that, like, Yeti.
Okay, so I welcome all of you for this edition of the Wednesday Colloquium. I am Jyotishman Dasgupta and the Colloquium Coordinator. And it's my great pleasure to have with us Professor Yuri Kipcher from the Australian National University for this session of the NSF Wednesday Colloquium. I just wanted to, before my colleague Professor Achanta Venugopal formally introduces Professor Kipcher, just wanted to tell you every Wednesday, we get together, all the natural sciences faculty at TIFR, physicists, chemists, and biologists at 4 o'clock. And we get to hear fantastic expositions of scientific talks from leading experts from around the world. And with the advent of course, the COVID pandemic, all of these talks are now online. And we get a chance to beam some of these talks through YouTube Live link. And thank you for joining us through the YouTube channel as well. And I would now formally ask Professor Achanta Venugopal to introduce our speaker today.
Thanks, Yedi. It's an honor to have Professor Kipcher today as our colloquium speaker. He's a distinguished professor and the head of the Nonlinear Physics Center of the Australian National University in Canberra, Australia. And he's also the research director of the International Research Center for Nanophotonics and Metamaterials in St. Petersburg, Russia. So he's a trained theoretician, but his pioneering research career covered significant fundamental contributions to solitons, nonlinear photonic crystals, topological insulators, and more recently, all dielectric metamaterials, which he'll be talking about today. He has about 850 publications with a H index of about 130. His contributions are recognized by numerous awards, which include the Harry Massey Medal and Prize of IOP, Institute of Physics UK, a Lebedev Medal, Lyle Medal, among others. So he's a fellow of Optical Society of America, American Physical Society, Institute of Physics UK, Australian Research Council, and Australian Academy of Sciences. So it's real honor to have you, Professor Kipcher. So we look forward to your colloquium.
thank you, Gopal, for introduction. It's a great pleasure for me to talk to many people in India because somehow I'm getting more and more connected to India and Indian research. With Professor Gopal, we shared it recently, a joint paper. And currently in my group, I have the first Indian students who originally comes from Delhi Institute of Technology, very smart guy. And I'm really happy to have more in the future. So I will talk about recent developments of metamaterials. I know people in India know metamaterials very well as a spin-off of plasmonic research, but I will mention about most recent development and recent hopes to get something really working and really useful. First of all, a few words about Australia. As you understand very, very well, it's a big piece of land, much bigger than India, but with a much smaller population of 26 million. So now, because of COVID, now our government locks the country, so we are sitting on the island as a prison and not traveling and not going anywhere. Even in local flights are very limited. Some states are still closed, but we basically have no COVID whatsoever. I mean, like 10 cases a day in the last few months. But Australia is an immigrant country and almost 30% born outside of the country. There's much more than the US. And we have a lot of nationalities. Of course, these days, I see more and more people from India working, particularly in IT industry. It's very, very popular to get degrees here. But historically, we get a lot of Greeks, particularly after the war. And Melbourne is the largest city of Greeks outside Greece. Also, it's not surprising for you too that we have a lot of beaches and nice coastline. But what is really surprising for you, and as was for me some years ago, that Australia has many interesting animals and a very huge population of wild camels. They were brought to Australia during the investigation of Central Parts, but we found the second homeland, and now it's a huge population. Some people say 1 million. So Saudi Arabia and Qatar actually export camels for camel raising. Okay, hope we will get some visitors from India in the future and we will be able to travel, but I'm back to science. I know many people know plasmonics. It's a huge and very active field of research, which studies sub-wavelength localization of light when electromagnetic waves propagate at the interface between dielectrics and metal, excite free electron and make a hybridization with electron wave functions and get very, very localized near the surface. And plasmonics had a lot of manifestation, a lot of promises, and manifestation in different type of modes excited at these interfaces. And basically, physics is that we have a when electromagnetic field interact with metals, it's create dipole moments and excite localized modes of the structure, which are manifested in different colors and many, many applications. Where metamaterials appeared on top of plasmonics by adding magnetic component to the these modes. So basically the word meta means in Greek beyond, and it was initially suggested by David Smith, who made the first experiment in microwaves. So basically idea is to compose a structure which will have a usual plasmonic modes, like electric modes, so associated with elements or metallic elements, which we called the electric meta atoms, and magnetic component associated with magnetic dipole mode. So it's initially it was a split ring resonator. When free electrons oscillated there, we excite magnetic moment. And basically we're able to get a magnetic response of non-magnetic materials due to this oscillating currents in elementary structures. So initial idea was to actually create a structure, which artificial structure with sub-wavelength order, which actually covers the entire plane of magnetic and electric response and create materials which will have properties not available in nature. Most intriguing initially was to create negative index materials, which are known very few in nature, not very common, and basically create different structures which different values of epsilon and mu, in particular zero mu, zero epsilon, very exotic materials. But in general, the entire concept pushed by John Pendry and others was to make a link between nature and our structures, in that sense that nature create structures made of elementary units, atoms, but we don't see atoms, they're very, very small. The electromagnetic waves, which we study here, or sound waves, whatever, everything macroscopically large in comparison with elements. And in that sense, metamaterials basically mimicking this entire concept. The small structures are not seen, but we look at the wave, which are much larger than these elementary units. And that's metamaterials was mainly described through average parameters. average, because we were able to actually look at macroscopic response due to change of microscopic structure. Of course, it was a lot of hype in metamaterial story, and a lot of papers in the top journals, and was a lot of interesting concept developed that basically most of them were based on this possibility to get different values of mu and epsilon in such structures. So optical magnetism, negative refraction, clocking, possibility to create a shield to clock electromagnetic waves and hide objects. Was a lot of hype in the newspapers and the media, optical circuitry, super lensing, hyper lensing, chirality effect. All this concept were developed on the basis of metamaterials, and we all were based on the possibility to look at the average characteristics of this new artificial structures. 5 years ago, my friend David Smith, who actually was first to observe metamaterials, and as we all believe will get Nobel Prize one day, he organized a conference, Metamaterial Science and Technology, to celebrate 15 years. Indeed, it was 15 years, already 20 years since the first experiment was done in a nice place of La Jolla. And that conference was actually followed invitation he got from Bill Gates to establish several companies which will be based on the concept of metamaterials. And that conference, I learned first about these efforts. There are a few companies which supported initially by Bill Gates, and we developed concept metamaterials to applications. And you see that it basically security, satellite communication, radars, you can find them on the web. And for example, my former students was employed by one of the companies, and it's a lot of activities. And currently I believe there are 22 companies, and even you can buy shares from some of them and based on this metamaterial concept and technology. One of the example I have from this evolved technology, maybe not very popular these days, it's to increase security in airports. So idea is to actually, instead of this bottleneck waiting places in the airport, we just have these screens. This is a prototype. And this screen works like multiple array antenna, which also based on both electric and magnetic responses, and screen people in passing and define some suspect, and then only suspect actually checked, and everybody else go free and not even notice that they were checked. One of the applications I've been involved in improvement of MRI technology. MRI machines are extremely expensive, they are not in every hospital. So idea is to actually use a metamaterial, a piece of metamaterial, or make a clothes made of metamaterial and enhance MRI signal. And not only enhance signal, but also substantially reduce time this patient spent in the chamber. That's also a very big problem for more than 10% of people who can't go spend in chamber a lot of time. And of course, it will save money for this upgrading of machine. So basically, metamaterials, the structures which composed of metallic and this dielectric structures shown here on the schematic. And from matter, we have the elementary unit. Here is the splittering resonator, which is responsible for magnetic dipole resonances. This structures all metamaterials, this metal, dielectric metal, parallel uniphase oscillations correspond to dipole moment, and anti-parallel oscillations correspond to magnetic dipole moment. So we all have these properties of metamaterials. However, as you notice, all the structures made of metals, and if you go from microwaves to optics, even in terahertz, still very fine, and we have a lot of interesting application of metamaterials in terahertz, but in optics, we have exactly the same problem like we have for plasmonics, because we use metals, free carriers, there is heating and laser losses. So possibilities for waveguiding, for other applications are extremely limited. So question is, if we can actually return back to metamaterial, dielectric and metamaterial concept and do something useful with the structures, again, using the same idea. As always, answer was for a long time, but it's more recently shaped into field, which I called the Mi-resonant metaphotonics. Editors of Nature call it Mi-tronics, and the very recent account of all this development in the review paper we just online in the ACS Photonics. So what is the idea? Of course, you can guess the idea from this name, Mi. Mi is not a province in Japan. It sounds like Asian word, but it's actually German scientist Gustav Mi, who was first who solved Maxwell equation exactly. That happened in 1908. So he, of course, he didn't have Mathematica. So many students may say that I'm joking because it's now easy, but you remember it more than 100 years ago, it was very difficult to do it. And because all this expansion and solution presented in the form of these long crocodiles with these special functions. But he was first who solved Maxwell equation exactly for the problem when we have a sphere made of whatever, epsilon mu, he is theorist, he may put any numbers, and then plane wave is scattered, a sphere and plane wave is scattering on the sphere, and you solve this field's scattering transmitted reflection, reflected. That was published in 1908, I mentioned, but of course, from physical point of view, we are interested very much in the meaning of the solution. So meaning of the solution is clear when we introduce dimensionless parameters. This is size of the sphere, this is wavelength of light. And depending on that dimensionless parameter, in fact, this problem covers almost everything what we have in optics in terms of scattering. That's why it's so popular. So basically it covers Rayleigh scattering and obviously can go to geometric optics, but we are mainly interested in Mi scattering, Mi resonances, Mi scattering. So what is the Mi resonances? Imagine these are pictures actually from his paper. You know, people in 1908 was as clever as we are, particularly without computers. So this is a sphere, and when light penetrates inside of the sphere, of course, if it's dielectric, it penetrates inside and actually excite the material. So what kind of material? Of course, if it's dielectric, this is displacement current, which electromagnetic wave excite. And then if lambda over n, lambda wavelength and refractive index will be comparable with the dimension, this wave will excite different modes. These are some sketches of the modes. So how to see difference between metals and dielectrics? I make a sphere made of metals and dielectric and try to compare. If my sphere is very, very small, of course I excite plasmonic resonances which are at the surface of metal dielectric interface. And these are resonances very sharp because they correspond to these modes excited in a small sphere. If I look at dielectric silicon here, nothing appears in the scattering efficiency. But if I increase size of this particle, what I see is that now plasmonic resonances becomes very broad, but this dielectric resonance is very sharp. What is most interesting is that if I look at the scattering cross sections for silicon, then first maximum very sharp, I mean, relatively sharp maximum correspond to magnetic dipole resonance. Magnetic dipole resonance when we have donut mode for electric field and dipole for magnetic component of the field. And only second resonance is electric dipole. People, of course, knew about that, but sometimes people ask me, where is the breakthrough? It was known for ages, and not this particular picture, but in general. So breakthrough is that you can see it for silicon, which is material of choice for photonics. which appears everywhere now, and then we basically can apply this concept of magnetic and electric response for structures made of silicon only when we have a geometrical relations to excite this particular mode. That was the initial development of these ideas, but later we realized that there are many, many more on top of that. What is more? Spheres are large, so not 15, a few hundred nanometers, so we support multipoles. Of course, multipoles are known, but we are known for more complicated structures like oligomers in plasmonics. But here, sphere is large, so it supports electric dipole, magnetic dipole, electric quadrupole, magnetic quadrupole, different type of modes. And these modes in their intensity depends on the shape of these particles. So what is naturally happens here, mode becomes interferer. And we create interesting patterns in emitted radiation and allows to control emitted radiation. The most fascinating, in my view, effect of this interference is so-called Kerker effect. Kerker effect was predicted by Kerker purely theoretically. He just said what will happen if you have epsilon equal mu and what will happen with pattern, with radiation pattern. But in fact, it's a very deep concept. If you go to interference studies in textbooks, so for interferences, in order to see any interference of fields, you do like a two slots, or because you need two sources of radiation. So when you have two sources, you need to place them at the distance of order of quarter of wavelength. And then you see in the far field, this nice interference patterns with enhancement and suppression of some places. Here we have two different types of dipoles, electric dipole and magnetic dipole. We can have them excited in a single particle and then we will interfere. And particularly because of field structure, if we overlap, we create unidirectional scattering. So exactly what we called the Huygens source, which is composed of two types of radiation field emitted from electric and magnetic dipole. You can do many different games with these patterns. This is more complicated transverse Kerker effect than we involved in dipoles and quadrupoles and look at the patterns which generated transversely to propagation direction. So a lot of games like that. But in addition to that, field, as I mentioned, penetrate inside of these particles and get enhancement inside because of excitation of resonance, particular magnetic dipole resonance, donut mode inside of the structure for electric field. So it allows to excite more material and get much stronger effect. So we may see a lot of enhancement effect, in particular nonlinear effect. But very recently we discovered that there is something else here, which is really fascinating and helps to think on applications. This is so-called bound state in the continuum. And I honestly believe people in optics did not hear much about that. Some people in mathematics and wave theory, they know on acoustic, even acoustic know better. So I start repeating those old basics. First of all, bound state in the continuum, as we know now, we appeared first in 1929. A lot of history in this talk, but it's just what happening. In 1929, pioneers of quantum mechanics von Neumann and Digner published a very strange paper. It's actually a very short paper, as you see, 5-7, only 3 pages, half pages front, 2 pages. We found exact solution of Schrodinger equation because we were working on quantum mechanics for Schrodinger equation, which actually existed in a continuum band. To explain the solution, I use a one-dimensional cartoon and first refresh your memory about simple quantum mechanical problems. This is a potential well propagating modes, so it's an extended wave function, free-moving quantum particles, and this is a trapping potential correspond to discrete level of energy or trap mode or localized mode. This is what everybody knows from chemistry, even biology, about quantum mechanics, localized and propagating modes. So what the bound state in the continuum are? So look at this potential. I just will modify it slightly. I made waved ages. So now I have, instead of two domains, positive energy, negative energy, I have three domains. Above and below is the same, but here it's much more interesting story. If a wave will interact with these humps, it gets reflected and transmitted, so it tunnels through these humps. And actually, because of all this tunneling and multiple reflection transmission, in principle, we can construct a solution which will be fully localized because compensation of this reflection transmitted waves.
Yuri, we just lost your sound.
Hope it did not happen.
Yes, yeah, we are back.
It did not happen half an hour ago, no?
Yeah, there's a box now. Could you put the box back up on the, it's on the screen. It's gone. It's fine.
Okay.
Continue.
Shall I start beginning or it happened before?
No. Just for like 2 seconds, it was gone. Don't worry.
Yeah. Tell me immediately.
The explanation of the bound state.
Good. Yeah. Okay, so this is a picture of bound states. It's not in the paper. Paper just found exact solution of three-dimensional potential with this periodic structure, which is very crazy to understand. It was not cited well, but this is a physics. So physics is possibility to create a fully localized state due to this reflection transmission and sitting in the continuum spectrum. Some people in electronic theory try to get experiments done super lattices were invented, investigated in semiconductor super lattices. It was several publications. I pick up two from my friend Federico Capasso, but it's observation of electronic bound state at the Bauer potential. Well, but it's not bound state in a continuum. It's just like defect modes in sitting between two mirrors. And then later, similar paper from another group of Bell Labs. So it was not true.
May I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
Yes.
So is it like the Fano resonance in atomic physics?
You are very smart guy. Wait a bit more.
Okay, thank you.
Wait a few more minutes, okay? Thank you for asking that. Yeah. Of course, it's fun. I will tell the truth. So no true big was observed here. And then it was a kind of side activity of mathematician. You know, it's actually many papers I discovered it, but it's journals like Annals of Physics, PhysRevue, Semi-Physical, Joel Physics A. People try to understand what von Neumann and Wigner predicted was a kind of theory, and even Neumann-Wigner type potential. And in 2008, this idea came to photonics. It was a first paper, a theory paper, a bit strange in terms of models and realization, but then famous Moti Segev did the first experiment. So first experiment was done for array of waveguides. So this is a long array of waveguides and two defects. So if wave interact with defects, of course it's scattered to both waves, because we have two defects, we can compensate wave coming forward and backward, and kind of localized states can be observed. Then big push, I was also involved in that, and we look at even nonlinear and soliton effect, but it was some time ago. And then big push happens with the photonic crystals, because people mainly at MIT group discovered this interesting state which appears like dark modes in the slab waveguides, photonic crystals. It's a different type of bound state in the continuum. And beginning of this year, we have a feature article in OPN, Optics Photonics New Journal.
Yuri, there's one question by Professor Pratap Raichaudhary. Pratap, can you unmute yourself?
The question that I have is that in your photonic experiment, the top one, where is the potential well? You have some periodic structure, but how big is the well there?
Good point. So that's more complicated because you need to see spectrum. So this is, don't try to map my sketch with this every single experiment, because there are several different bound state in the continuum, at least four types, general types. So don't try to match exactly. But here what happens is it's exactly compensation of two types of A. I will explain in a second the basic physics, but this reflection from one defect, reflection another defect, wave propagate along the, inclined wave propagate along this waveguide array in that direction, but under some angle, and then it scatters by defect. So you need to have top picture. I can send you some more information later on if you're interested, but that's not main point. And there are several bound state in the continuum. So don't try to map to my simple picture. It's just very schematic and different type appears. This I introduce the simplest bound state in the continuum, which we know like a one-dimensional type. Of course, you look at slab waveguide. So in slab waveguide, if you propagate modes, we're usually leaky. you need different indices to trap light inside, but usually for not match indices, you have leaky modes. So we propagate right way and left and right. So this is dispersion curve, which I bend because I want to make periodicity. They're folded, but it's usually not folded for this homogeneous waveguide. But I want to introduce periodicity here. It's a typical grating, very well known in optics. And I'm sure most of you saw this band gaps diagrams and grating. So, but what is most interesting, when I introduce grating, I actually produce coupling between these two modes through grating. So they become coupled, particularly this type of diagram described by couple mode theory. But most interesting is that if I look at this age and that age, they correspond to completely different type of Bloch modes. These Bloch modes, it's non-radiating solution, and it has a compensated leakage from the waveguide slab. But these modes correspond to enhanced interference, to enhanced leakage from the waveguide. So this state here is exactly bound state in the continuum, because this Bloch mode becomes decoupled from continuum spectrum. It's orthogonal to continuum spectrum. I can't be excited unless I incline radiation coming. So due to destructive interference, similar to that potential which I mentioned, but of course in a different picture, there is no potential here. So potential will appear if I look transversally somehow. The main idea is to use interference to suppress leaking from this state. And that's a basic concept. So most of these, I mean, all of this bound state in the continuum appears through specific suppression of radiation. And if radiation can be suppressed totally, then of course we come to the state which is fully localized. Of course, we have different already activities, and particularly MIT group published a review paper in new journal Nature Reviews Materials about bound state in the continuum. And they had the box in that review, which I was very happy not reading, because the box, I just passed it, and box was telling the non-existence of single particle bound state in the continuum of compact structure. In fact, we were not right, because previous years, it was a published paper, but from Andrea Lu and his that time students, Francesco Monticone, who use epsilon near zero material to show that if you put epsilon near zero layer, then we can get actually trap radiation inside in three-dimensional structure. But anyway, message was that if you get something compact, we will never get a bound state in the continuum. And that's, of course, really not true, because we should remember that there are several mechanisms to appear, these special states to appear. One which I mentioned, this comes from photonic crystals. This is a slab waveguide with a special type of symmetries to suppress leakage up and below. But there are several other mechanisms, and it looks like one of the very often mechanisms which you can find, I believe, now in almost every system, and people saw it. It's so-called Friedrich Winger mechanism. It's a paper published in 1995. So what does it tell us? That if you have two modes which are non-orthogonal, we become coupled through strong interaction. The strong interaction coupling produce, of course, repulsion crossing, unavoidable crossing here, and produce some states which exactly bound state in the continuum. Believe or not, many people saw this and we call it duck states. So duck states is exactly what we are looking for. It's the states which decouple from the continuum of modes supported by the structure. So if you know about this different mechanism, we can look at these particular states in a very simple open resonator. And that was the most fascinating observation which we made several years ago. That was, if you look at this just simple resonator, it's open resonator. So if I look at the wave propagating from top, for example, wave will come, then because of large index, it will get localized, something localized will happen there, and then of course it will leak. So this open resonator does not support any localized mode, it only supports leaky mode. But leaky modes here are such that we have some localized area here, and of course leakage if you look at that direction. So imagine that we will have two modes, exactly remember about that potential. I was telling you about reflection and transmission. We need interference. We need two modes at least. So one leaky mode and second leaky mode will coexist together. If I get a resonator to support two leaky modes, I may compensate leakage from top and bottom and create localized state. The question is where to get these modes. An amazing thing is that if I look at this resonator and will play with height of some size, you will discover that modes in this resonator actually remember their origin. Modes, one more type of mode, remember origin from knee resonances. The other type of modes, when I increase this height, we remember about Fabry-Perot type of structure because I need quarter of wavelength to get Fabry-Perot effect between bottom and top of this resonator. So these two modes have a different inclination angle. Even they belong to the same family TETM, this particular for T, we have different inclination, and then inclination means that the mode may couple. And believe or not, we try different systems, you play with geometric parameters and you find more and more examples when this happens, just people missed it completely. So in this simple resonator, I can create a strong coupling between two leaky modes and actually come to the situation when one mode will have enhanced leakage and the other one will have suppressed leakage. And this suppressed leakage correspond to duck states. And this duck states is based on the physics of bound state in the continuum because I suppress leakage from both sides. That was in a theory paper, but then we tried to do experiments. And I am happy to say that we did experiments and for different frequencies. This is just appeared today in Advanced Materials. It's a microwave experiment done in ITMO University in Russia. With ceramic with high index, with varying shape, and you see the sharp modes correspond to very sharp resonances with quality factor more than 12,000. And early this year, we published optics mid-IR experiment in Science when we push Q about 200. So of course, Q of mu modes, very well known, it's less than 10. Everybody knows that. That's why these mi resonances were not highly used. And of course, people knew about them, but it was no big application avenue. But here we can actually adjust parameters in such way that we can actually push Q to up to 200. In nanophotonics, this is extremely important, but this is only first indication. So what we have in that paper, which appeared online today, we have a table for different different frequency ranges. In particular, what we didn't try, if you look at germanium and near infrared, of course, we have material Q, radiative Q, and total Q. So it shows the largest Q factor for this this isolated resonator. So I believe this is only beginning of something very interesting.
Yuri, just a quick question. What was the size of those resonators? The
length? Several hundred nanometers. So
you hundreds of nanometers. So you
You need hundreds of nanometers because you need, you remember, lambda over n.
Right.
Of course, everything depends on n, right. Refractive index. If you invent in optics something with N60, like in microwaves, that it will be smaller size. But size is defined by refractive index. You need to get wavelength light trapped inside. Lambda over n is wavelength of light should be compared with geometric size.
Sure. So, and how do you make these germanium? So, you just nanofabricate some sort of
that was fabricated by our Korean colleagues, and basically described in that science paper. It's we transfer it single by single, so we don't do lithography because we can't do lithography. It's in the glass. It's aluminium gallium arsenide. So we fabricate it and transfer on the glass. And that's why we can't do metasurface in that way, only isolated resonators. But it's described in supplementary. One smart fellow asked me about fan resonances. I am very happy to answer. So what is the point here? If I work with the exact bound state in the continuum, it's really mathematical exercise. It's a single point when I compensate the tails left and right, and it's a solution which is exist in single point when this compensation happen. It has a very, I mean, zero line. It has Q infinity. And this is the definition of bound state in the continuum. It's a special type of states which has Q infinity. And that's people somehow confuse. We said, okay, infinity, you can't get infinity. First of all, your samples are finite. You have a lot of things, and so, but in physics, we are not interested in bound state in a continuum, believe or not. We are interested in quasi-bound state in a continuum. And why it's interesting? It's interesting because when I lift this strict definition of compensation, I open tails, so I made some leakage. And we need controlling not only Q, but also leakage. It's very important. And then as soon as I open tails, leakage map me to the physics of fan resonances. Thanks for that question. Actually, fan resonances, this is a reverse problem. So we look at the wave, which is scattered by oscillator or oscillating mode. Then the wave, when it becomes comparable with this oscillator parameter or frequency, get reflected or transmitted. But it's exactly reverse bound state of in continuum problem when we allow some leakage, so we allow access from outside. And this is all happenings below, above light line, so below light line. So basically we are working with continuum spectrum. We will pump the states and remove energy from the state. So in fact, what we have here, physical object is quasi-bound state of quasi-bound state in continuum, which is exactly fan resonance. Why don't use fan resonance? Because fan resonance, it's a very big concept in wave optics. And actually it appears when I have in kind of interference of two very, very different narrow and broad lines resonances. So fan resonance may not convert to quasi-big or big, or very rarely convert. But what's happening here, every quasi-big is actually fan resonance, because as soon as I open leakage, I just produce the physics of fan resonances.
Recently, another question, Yuri.
Yeah,
sorry,
yeah, sure.
Again, interrupting.
No. That's question, a difficult point, yeah.
Yeah, there's a question from YouTube. It says, Vikas Kumar says, maybe get some comments for the states in Maxwell-Garnett structure. Can they be BIC so that we get more non-linearity?
Yeah, sure, absolutely. Because we excite more density, I mean, we excite energy in a particular area, and of course we can get more non-linearity. Yeah, sure.
Okay. Yeah.
Look, we try to compare this. We look at different sizes, play with this resonator, and we try to map to fun of physics. It's not yet published, not yet even submitted. But you see that basically we can exactly map this quasi-big resonances. So why it's important big? Because of physics related to this big concept. Quasi because it can't compensate exactly. So it has leakage. So quasi-big, this is a physical big which we operate with. And but it's exactly Fano. You see line shape, Fano actually can depends on Fano parameter Q, reverse this asymmetry. We can map theory and experiment. This is dependence of Fano parameters, and even measure it and numerically constructed Fano line shape from experiments. It's very, very very cute experiments done in my lab in Canberra by my PhD student from Russia. And in science, we try to push nonlinear effects, and actually due to this excitation of big or hybrid mode, which correspond to this overlapping of two Mie resonances, we observe record high conversion efficiency from single aluminum gallium arsenide resonator. So nonlinear effect, but I excluded nonlinear effect from here. It's another story. Now, many people ask me, where is this resonators on a plane of quality factor and mode volume? This is a graph which show you different ideas, different resonators. Of course, a lot of activities in micro resonators, micro disc, micro rings. We push Q factor very high. I don't present here this membrane photonic crystals, but you see that from several papers, very high Q factors. But we, of course, they are large and they correspond to relatively large mode volume. Plasmonics provide very small mode volume, but still very low Q factors. Mie modes, they a bit better, but still the particles are larger. So still mode volume is relatively large. So this quasi-big concept allows to push substantially higher Q factor with relatively small mode volume. That's we are saying that it's a future of nanophotonics in terms of sub-wavelength localization of life. So currently we are working to push it up, and I may tell you preliminary, it's not even written yet, that combining several resonators, we can push, of course, under special condition, remember interference is a key word, we can push Q factor even higher, keeping almost the same mode volume. So basically the story is that we now see developments of new older electric structures where clever engineering of interferences can allow you to make the structure relatively sub-wavelength and with very small losses, high nonlinear effect and different type of enhancement of different effects. I finished the first part. I don't have much time as I see, but I have second part which is even more excited.
Yuri, do not be worried. We have time. Don't worry. We have time.
Okay. So second part is.
And there is a question.
Can I interrupt here? Sorry, Professor Kushal. Can you just go back one slide here?
Yeah.
So here you consciously mentioned a phrase relatively subwavelength, right? So here you have four structures that you are showing of silicon, right? So what is the actual localizing structure? It is the collection of the entire four structures together.
You're talking about what? This picture?
Yeah, exactly. So now here
I'm not prepared to discuss it. It's not even written. Sorry.
Okay. So let me
just single particle. This is all because like micro disc, micro ring here.
Okay, so let me leave that question aside. But in one of your earlier slides where we discussed the germanium resonator.
It's here.
The size was, I think, roughly 970 or something nanometer diameter.
And
you showed that the quality factor increased up to the optimal size and then decreased again.
It's increase and decrease again.
One behind this.
Because it depends on the mode overlap. So this geometric parameter, this diameter, controls this mode overlap, because this bound state in the continuum appears. It's appear through hybridization of two Mi modes of Mi Fabry-Perot type. It's a modes of resonator, you know, and that's why I need a specific point. Of course, it's always will go up and down, because that's a matching condition when this mode overlap and leakage is suppressed. So basically around this point, I suppress leakage from both sides. And that's why it's maximum, because for larger structures and for smaller structures, I don't have the suppression. We all support Mi resonances, but you can't go to very small sizes, and this diameter is defined by height. So if I will change height, I will reduce diameter, but it still will be no less than 500 nanometers diameter.
Okay.
So we saw taller one, but this is not taller. It's like a, you know, it's a disc, you know, not a pillar. In for pillar, you can make it smaller, but still we need to make taller.
Okay, there's one more question by Pratap, Professor Pratap Rajchaudhary. Pratap, could you unmute?
Yeah. What I wanted to ask is that if you have Anderson localized, is that an example of a bound state within a continuum? So in a way, how is that different from the disordered, or is that
Ah, you mean no? In disorder, for example, Anderson. You mean Anderson localization or something
Anderson
like that, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
Of
Anderson
course,
localization.
We have many waves. We have many waves and all this cancellation, of course, like Anderson localization. Here we have only two waves, two leaky waves. So, and then adjust it in that way. Of course, everything in background of wave physics and how many waves. Of course, we can go to more waves, but it's already for three waves, we get troubles to describe a strong coupling. With two waves, two modes, strong coupling is known. It leads to Rabi oscillation, to all this couple mode theory. And it's simple, but with many waves, it's just simple cancellation. But here is in one disk, it appears through strong coupling, not only cancellation for strong coupling.
Okay.
Okay, let me move to the second part, which is metasurfaces. Of course, I try to shape it around Mi resonances, but I need to say a few words about metasurfaces themselves. So of course, metasurfaces is now a very hot topic, and many people work on that, but really Federico Capasso pushed it, and this is his slide, which I borrowed when he visited Canberra, and he tried to present this idea like possibility to change wavefront direction propagation through patterning. For example, he employ idea of Huygens resonances when every point of the surface becomes source of secondary radiation, a secondary wavelength by itself. And now if I change the surface somehow, I can redirect or change profile of this wavelength and redirect my beam in different direction. Of course, many people argued that this is a diffracting grating or something like that, which is partly true, because here we are not basically interested what will happen here. We're interested in this supplementary wave number, which varies along the surface. And this auxiliary wave number can change our reflection properties, or change Snell's law, because of the possibility to create different structures, patterns of this metasurface. In particular, what of course, there are many groups. If you look at the conferences, many papers, 100 papers about metasurfaces. In particular, me and my collaborators are interested in pushing two concepts with metasurfaces, actually very much related to today's talk. One is employment of multipoles for very highly efficient transmission, actually Kerker and generalized Kerker effect. And the second strategy is employing bound state in a continuum for sharp resonances. I will briefly describe both of them and applications, and I believe you will find something useful for your personal work in these ideas. First of all, highly efficient transmission. So how we can move resonances? We move from Mi to simple disk. Mi has exact solution, Mi theory, all exact analytical forms which we can program, but they not flexible because we have only one radius, one parameter. In disk, we have height and radius. We can change them and actually move resonances. Also, it was my group first, which we discovered that if we change parameters, we actually can overlap magnetic and electric resonances. That was a big surprise for us. And we sent our that time postdoc, Isabel Steude, to Sandia when she fabricated many, many structures. She is German, and of course, she was very precise in that. Fabricated hundreds of structures with varying parameters. We did not know at that time how to calculate everything precisely, and she found overlaps. And when as I mentioned to you, Kerker effect, when you overlap magnetic and electric dipole resonances, we come to unidirectional scattering, and that's what we observed. Unidirectional scattering, because we have two resonances, each resonance associated with pi change, and we can have a complete 2 pi phase coverage by metasurface and very, very high transmission, close to 91%. Of course, similar to big, as you mentioned, that exactly happens for specific set of parameters when we overlap these resonances. And of course, it's very much dependent period. It's a long story, but the question is how to make these metasurfaces broadband. So to have this high transmission, unidirectionality transmission in the, for larger wavelength bands. Answer came again from multipoles, and I keep telling you that there are a few keywords in this field. Interferences, like in plasmonics, we have hotspots. Here we have interferences and multipoles, and this is extremely important. You will see many examples of that. This is a simple metasurface. This is element, you know, this dielectric pillar. And if I just want to satisfy for specific polarization Kerker effect conditions, that I see that point in transmission when I achieve almost 100 transmission for specific polarization, but the rest is just immediately dropping, so it's not broadband operation. If I look at the log scale, this corresponds to the specific condition when Kerker condition satisfied, you see very narrow peak. And question is how to make it broadband. So answer we found also very few years ago, if I try to increase pillar, I enter this Fabry-Perot modes and I trap only quarter wavelength, but half wavelength, and I can actually create several Kerker conditions. If I create several Kerker conditions for this two different magnetic dipole mode, I have these two peaks. And now if I operate between these two peaks, I can actually achieve very broad transmission. It will be almost 100% transmission for metasurface composed of these pillars with any phase imprinted. Of course, you need to look at interaction, but actually can be used for different type of broadband operating what we call meta devices. Meta devices, of course, based on meta material concept. We fabricated the structures and published in this established that time established journal APL Photonics, where my friend Ben Eggleton is a chief editor. We look at half wavelength, quarter wavelength, different type of devices. And this is a table which was composed by my postdoc in 2017 of different efficiencies in transmission of different meta devices. You see, with these meta surfaces, we can do different type of structures. They will be flat, almost flat, lens, oxycon, holograms, beam deflectors, Q-plates, and different type of structures which people use. This gray one is actually plasmonic. You see, in transmission, plasmonic does not work very well. Of course, it works much, much better in reflection and absorption, but in transmission, plasmonic does not provide good efficiencies. This is dielectric. People switch to dielectric around 6 years ago, and this is different efficiencies, and we still keep record because we know how to operate with multipoles to achieve the highest transmission. Transmission is achieved through this interplay of these multipoles, as I mentioned previously. What we can do with metasurfaces, you can imagine immediately many applications, so it's almost transparent slab of structured surface with any face you can imprint. So basically its thickness is around of half wavelength because we need still taller pillars. And one of the idea was to marry meta surfaces with optical communications, particularly with mod multiplexing. We tried to publish this paper in optical communication community. It didn't work. People still don't accept these ideas. But this is a simple example when we have a multi-mode fiber and you transmit different profiles from multi-mode fibers, which are imprinted by metasurface, which of course at the edge of these fibers. You see metasurface without any optimizations give you relatively high transmission efficiencies, larger than 80, almost 100. And we can imprint and look at the data transmission that was measured in Chalmers University, the group of Peter Andreksen, the data transmission from multimode fibers. What is really interesting, you can immediately think about many other applications. And one of the very, very recently emerging application is for quantum photonics. I don't have many slides because it's a long story, but I just, people who are interested, we just submitted review paper with my another friend from India, Girish Agarwal, very well-known fellow for quantum optics, who corrected all our mistake, which we made with my former students, Alex Onsev. There are different applications of this transparent metasurfaces for quantum, and I believe it will still come. And it's also a lot of developments in atomic physics with lattices of emitters. So I switch to the second topic, this use of bound state in a continuum, and we'll explain you how metasurfaces can be useful here. This is another type of bound state in a continuum. So this is a general concept. You can see several mechanisms. So how we came to that idea? We noticed many publications, including publications of our friends about sharp resonances in the metasurfaces. Some people call them symmetry broken and Fano resonances. So idea is the following. You have a metasurface, which is a lattice of these elements. If these elements are symmetric, then at gamma point, this is a normally propagating wave, you don't excite any modes and this transmit. But people notice that if you make some symmetry breaking structures in the metasurfaces, you can observe sharp resonances, which we identify with Fano. But then we got idea that it's probably manifestation of bound state in the continuum. This is a different example we took from literature. And indeed, all these resonances can be explained by physics of bound state in the continuum. So what is really happening here? You have this normally propagating mode. If I break symmetry, I open leakage channel and I couple normally propagating wave to modes in the lattice and I couple it with this very specific wavelengths and quality factor. We can put all these cases on a single graph, which radiative Q factor, inverse square inversal proportion of this asymmetry factor, and that describe you how this bound state in the continuum appears. And then, of course, this means that if you know how to engineer asymmetry, you can basically create metasurface with any value of Q factor. Of course, this radiative Q factor, you need to understand that fabrication may change your structures. And then basically achieve, in the theory, of course, Q can go to infinity, very, very narrow resonances. People do it, and several groups demonstrated this very sharp resonances. Particular at the end of last year, group from Guangzhou, from Silicon, they took the structures and play. We had very good students to play and stay at night in labs. And this is from their paper, what we reported, Q factor 18,000 in this simple silicon metasurface on the glass. Of course, you need to make symmetry breaking. This can be done through this notch, this stump here, or this slight asymmetry, which we use in many of our papers. And so we basically can create a structure which will show you sharp resonances in transmission. And of course, you can do in reflection by just reflecting from different mirrors, electric and magnetic. How we can use it? This idea was to actually use it in biosensing. My colleague Hatice Altug from Switzerland, she did not believe that it will ever work. I spent a few days in Lausanne trying to convince her, and then we came to the idea of this sensor. This mid-IR sensor, which consists of this pixelated metasurface. So metasurface made of pixels. Each pixel has this tilted bar, tilting control of this asymmetry parameter of bound state in the continuum. So different pixels we need in order to create a comb of these resonances. So you see that this structure has multiple resonances associated with this particular points of this metasurface. Now, if I put analyte on top in mid-IR, different vibrations of molecules will show different reduction of transmission or reflection. And then I can map structure on analyte on this in a space like a simple barcoding and use without any spectrometer, but just simple projection technique to actually define absorbance of this structure and define what type of substances I can actually use. What is important here, this concept based on bound state in the continuum, a quasi-bound state, because we use tilting. Tilting actually provide type of resonance. And Q factor here was less than 200. And this is important because we need to cover very, very large band with these resonances. And if I use very, very sharp resonances, I need more and more pixels to actually make it work efficiently. Of course, this idea can be developed in different directions. We develop in for angle tilted because that resonance is very stable for tilting, but it's also shift when you tilt your beam. And we also use hyperspectral imaging to define different resonances. It's a highlight of some of the activities in OPN end of the year issue. What else you can do? The sharp resonance is a very useful for nonlinear effect, which I excluded from this talk, but I just want to show many people got interest in 2D materials. This is an extremely interesting possibility to actually combine high resonances with the exciton resonances on nonlinearities of 2D materials. This is our recent work with my former students, Alex Onsev, who is assistant professor at UTS University in Sydney. 2D materials is placed on silicon with this asymmetric bars. This is third order material, and we look at second harmonic generation. So it's enhanced from this 2D material due to presence of bound state in the continuum, and enhancement is extremely large. What else we can do? We can break symmetry transversally. So instead of breaking symmetry in plane, we can break symmetry transversely. For example, these two discs have different heights. And due to that, we can control and geometry and heights, we can control position of resonances. This is microwave experiment, but it's also gave us push to suggest interesting chiral bound state in the continuum. So what is the kind of effect here? You look at two bars, tilted bars, we shift them vertically. So we break symmetry in two cases. We break symmetry in plane by making tilted bar in transversely, transversely plane by shifting them. And we can create a structure which will do the following. It will propagate with 100% very narrow resonance, one circular polarization, and it will reflect completely opposite polarization. So we call it maximum chirality effect for this metasurface. Of course, very hard to fabricate such structures, but we are working on some prototypes with microwaves. I just at the end, I know that I use a lot of time, and few words about other application of bound state in the continuum. First, you should remember there are different types, at least four major type of bound state in the continuum: Fabry-Perot base, this defect base, planar, this strong coupling effect based, and also this like we have symmetry protected like in the photonic crystal membranes. I just mentioned few effects from recent activities. First of all, this. And if you look at the photonic crystal membrane, at the gamma point, bound state at gamma point actually correspond to non-trivial topology. It actually has a vortex type phase accumulated. And this can be used to actually generate vortices. That was demonstrated in a recent paper by my Chinese colleagues and also used by us to achieve ultra-fast control of vortex microlasers. So this is a lasing membrane made of perovskite in collaboration with Chinese group in Shenzhen. So topology very interesting. Now, second interesting point, a recent publication from MIT group, you can merge different bound state in the continuum. This is a great power because we can immediately increase, we increase by two orders of magnitude, Q factor, we merge. This is the points on the case space. We saw how you merge several bound state in the continuum into a super bound state in the continuum with a very high Q factor. Another idea came from my collaboration with Ranjan Singh, who played with the shapes, you know, with broken symmetry of these dielectric metasurfaces and discovered that the surface support several types of bigs. This is a normal one, which is, as I describe, broken symmetry in the plane. But then when you play with thickness of the structure, you enter another one, very sharp and generalized bound state in the continuum. So we are surrounded by bound state in the continuum. And point is to find them and explore them. Of course, I mentioned one of the important points, not only fight for large Q and for large localization, but also interesting point, which we got very recently, to enhance leakage. And its leakage also can be controlled, not only enhance, but also control. And for this leakage, we can do very interesting things. That's a recent work, my collaboration with Dinpin Tsai and the NTU group, for virus manipulation in the membrane, we can actually change in thickness. We can control leakage for this strong coupling and enhance optical forces by two orders of magnitude and also trap the particles in particular order just because of enhanced optical focus and control leakage. And finally, for people who still like plasmonics, I want to mention that there are many interesting directions of research. And one of the interesting directions, which I didn't see any experiment yet, so-called hybrid plasmonic photonic structures. This first theory paper was published a few years ago. I asked Sasha Kildyshev why we didn't go with experiment, and I didn't get a clear answer, but idea is, of course, if you get the plasmonics, I mean, metallic and dielectric structures combined, of course, Biggs comes from wave physics. You can beat low Qs of plasmonic systems and get some interesting effects for localization. The idea to beat losses was shown here when we observed bound state in the continuum as a special type of this anisotropic metasurfaces fabricated at Swinburne University through this two-photon polymerization, and the surface was covered by very thin gold. And we can also see anisotropic bound state in the continuum here. So I come to conclusion. Sorry for very long talk. I wanted to finish earlier, but I tried to explain the most difficult things, assuming that people may get interested. So first of all, I try to convince you that field of metamaterials is still alive, but it was Rembrandted recently. So if you look at the number of citation Clio papers, for example, metamaterials rare, and many people now use metasurfaces or meta-optics, metaphotonics. Meta reflects this concept of magnetic dipole response. So we are interested in magnetic response of non-magnetic materials through structuring of surfaces or other types of structuring. Of course, we are mostly interested in dielectrics because of high refractive index allows to use mi resonances, trap light in smaller volumes. They're still not very small, but still can be made subwave length. And really we come to the situation, we can suggest a different type of useful meta devices and meta surfaces. Of course, we all based on resonances. So this averaging and average parameters, which classics of metamaterials used previously, not working here, but it's employ all this different type of resonances. And it looks like bound state in the continuum is a very useful concept. Of course, this is not a mathematical concept. This is a physical concept. So we control leakage, we control localization for this interference effect. Thank you very much and sorry for long talk.
No, it was perfect. Thank you, Yuri. This is fascinating talk. Absolutely, being an expert and the leader in this community, I think this was a talk that we all wanted to hear. And that's why Professor Venugopal had told all of us that we should transmit this talk through YouTube so that many people across the institutes in India could hear. So thank you very much for your time.
I'm happy with that. Thank you.
It's 11 o'clock in the night, right?
Yes, something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you for staying up this late. And I will now ask all my colleagues here to, if there are questions, please unmute yourself. And also, if you have a video, please switch on the
video. Sudipta has a question.
Yeah, Sudipta. Yeah.
Yeah. Hi. Fantastic talk and learned a lot. I just have a very simple question. So all these things that you're showing mostly in the near infrared region, they can all be translated to the visible, right? I mean, it's just a matter of getting the right material. Maybe it's not so easy to manufacture, but if you have the right material, just as a matter of scaling, right?
I know in India, there are a lot of smart guys. Thank you for this question. Of course, yeah. I shown silicon, but silicon metasurfaces because fabrication is very well advanced for silicon. But of course, silicon is not good for visible. That's why mid-IR, what we are working on, also we were targeting some telecom application initially. Of course, people for metasurfaces, for visible, for metal lenses, we use different materials. For example, for visible, it's titanium dioxide, which many people use, and that's perfect metal lenses for visible. But for me, of course, you should understand that many of these metasurfaces people use were based on this concept. Even people do not realize them. I asked my friend Federico Capasso some years ago how he actually optimized his metasurfaces. And he said, of course, we do routine optimization with help of postdocs in many, many cases. Of course, we need a larger index to get this mi resonances working for good materials in visible. So material as you mentioned, it's an important issue for particular wavelength. We need low losses. And also, I didn't mention a few recent activities we had. We tried to pump very strongly these metasurfaces and observe the high harmonic generation up to 11th harmonic, which usually people observe in gases. Of course, for this one, material also important, because if you do silicon, you excite free carriers, and there is a degradation of our resonances because of this. We are dealing with semiconductors after all. So for visible titanium dioxide, people tried germanium, but it's also a kind of trade-off of different scales.
Okay.
Scales and materials.
I have another question, but I will come back.
Okay, I have to take one YouTube question that has been pressing for some time. Sudiptada, you can come back again. Rakesh from YouTube is asking, if you go back to an MRI slide, really at the introduction, he has a question. In the MRI picture of the fish, some places high resolution were there, but in other places signals were significantly reduced. So he really wants to know why is that, and if you can go back to that slide one more time, to the MRI enhancement.
No, I'm not working on that. I was working initially. Now there are my colleagues working on that. My former student, Alexei Slobozhenyuk, actually even have a company in Russia. So I can direct that fellow to just send me email and I will direct you to, we have many more advanced. That's first, one of the first papers when I was initially initiating, but I stepped down and because we didn't get any funding for that in Australia.
So okay, so I would request
email and I send you many papers. I'm not working on that right now. Sure. Yeah.
So I would request Rakesh Singh to kindly email Yuri in the email address that Yuri has provided here in the slide and contact him directly. He would be able to address it much better offline.
It's okay? Actually a lot of activities. There is a French group, consortium. I am just very partly involved because I am driven by different ideas. Even sure. I stayed from the beginning, I'm not working on that. But sure. People actually improve it substantially. Right. And even already talking about kind of dress element, for example, for different cancer diagnostic, and it's very well advanced. Yeah.
Yes, yes. So I will take two questions in the comment box and I'll come back to Sushil and Sudipto again and the other people. So Keshav Samrat Modi, who is joined in the Zoom, but he can't ask the question through his audio, he's asking, apart from the bar and the loop, what other geometrical structure support the bound in continuum states or Fano resonance?
Whew, you're smart guys. Yeah, no, I know that India has very good people. No, of course, that's we don't understand yet, but people try, in particular, this symbol cubes and different geometries. I a bit of cheated you because when I show Kerker effect, the simple Kerker effect, of course, can be observed in any structure. In particular, because we have a basic electric and magnetic dipole resonance. Hello?
Right. No. It was just an echo. Don't worry about it.
Yeah. But this transverse Kerker effect obtained for cuboids. In cuboids, positions of resonance is different. So geometry is also key issue here because geometry defines a position of resonances and their overlap. I did not mention about interesting effect like we call anapole. Anapole is a very near field localized structure which appears, state, which appears through interference or superposition of dipole and toroidal modes. So this also depends on shape very much. So okay. Shape is crucial. So.
Okay.
Many shapes, many papers. You can try.
Sure,
no,
sure.
Really,
okay.
Guys, I'm really honest. I just it surprises every day, even for me. You know, it's interesting field. Deeper you look at that, more interesting things happening if you look deeper. But there are some key ingredients. You need to trap resonances, so you need high index. Second, you need to play with geometrical parameters, like you saw heights and widths. And then you should look at the mods and the coupling, you know, and then you produce something fascinating.
Sure. Okay, thank you. I have Sushil, who was waiting for some time. Sushil,
sorry,
could you ask the question?
One thing, there's one more question which was on the Zoom, right? Like,
sorry.
I mean, this question is about, is BIC at the interface or much above? So, I mean, he's basically asking where the localization.
Sorry about that.
Yes, field localization.
No, of course, inside, because it's dielectric field penetrate inside, and this is a mode of the particle, of the resonator. So that's a bulk mode of that resonator. It's like a Mi mode. So big in a single particle, this is a hybridization of two Mi type, Fabry-Perot type modes. In a metasurface, of course, this is very much connected to surface lattice mode. This is a collective large extended modes. And they are similar to lattice modes, which sometimes people excite, but of course, not they are quite different. We describe in our review with Kirill Koshelev the difference between lattice modes and the bound state in the continuum modes.
Okay, and there is one more question from Keshav. Can you comment on the multiple Fano resonance?
Whew, very interesting. I don't know about multiple when we actually superimpose these resonances, but because we never look at the deeper. But quasi-big, it's a Fano resonance. But what will happen when I try to superimpose them, I don't know.
Okay, Sushil, could you ask a question, please?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Yotishman. I have a couple of smallish questions. And firstly, Yuri, fantastic presentation as always. Thoroughly enjoyed that. So,
thank you.
Welcome. So my first question is about the analyte sensor that you showed, which had like a multiple two-dimensional array of multiple tiny subwavelength resonators.
Yep.
And do I understand you right that the broadband response comes because every individual resonator is a BIC in itself?
No. Not resonator. So this is it's not resonator. It's metasurface composed of pixels.
So at this one.
This is metasurface composed of one type of resonator. So these are pixels.
Yeah. So the question that I had was, is the individual pixel responsible for one individual wavelength, and is it the change in alignment?
Yeah.
Okay.
So individual pixel consists of identical these tilted bars. Then there is a scaling factor. So you know the scaling factor means that we change size of this tilted bar. It's very hard to do with other type of resonators. At least we did not get a clear idea. But with this one, it's just scaling, very simple scaling will help. And this is a scaling factor which allows you to move this position of resonance. Yeah.
So by putting them all together, you are basically spanning the entire visible, entire wide spectrum. That's the idea, right?
Yeah. But still, this structure is relatively large. You see 3 microns. So we need the mid-IR because of all this vibration oscillations of our substances we used. So, but what my comment was that this 10 by 10, so accidentally we got a very good agreement because Q factor was not very high. If we go to higher Q factor, like 1,000, we need many more pixels to actually cover the entire domain of frequencies. We need to overlap at least,
Yeah. So, Yotishman, can I take a quick second question?
Yeah, do that. And then I'll ask Sudipto. Yeah.
Sure. So in the previous, there's an empirical, almost, it's a law actually, alpha, 1 over alpha square law for the quality factor. It's in the previous slide. If you go back to the previous, just one slide before, I believe.
Yeah.
1 over alpha square. No, you showed a slide in which you plotted the radiative quality factor goes as 1 over alpha square. Yeah, see, I mean, it's
this one.
Yeah, it's, it's such a fantastic fit that this should motivate an analytical theory for quality factors, wouldn't it?
But we have analytical theories there. As usually, everything is supplementary, you know.
Okay, I thought it was data.
Oh, supplementary to that paper, yeah.
Oh, nice. Yeah, I would imagine, definitely. This is fantastic.
Yeah, yeah. We have, what was missing, to my great surprise, you mentioned today about FANO, link between FANO, between scattering coefficients and big, we also established that link. So basically, we have another paper, Advanced Photonics, and we have that analytical relation between FANO and quasi-big. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Fascinating. Sudipto? Unmute. Please.
Yeah, I'm still alive, but I suggest let's stop probably here at this stage.
Okay.
And I will get the emails if you don't mind.
Yeah. Sure. Thank you very much, Yuri.
Thank you very much for your interest and very good and smart questions. I hope Indians will now work on big, and I will be very happy to see more papers coming from India.
Thank you, Yuri.
Thank you. Bye.
Okay. Take care, guys. So I'll just close this session right now. So for next week, okay. Bye.
Bye.
For next week, colloquium, we have Professor D. Lee from the Chinese Academy of Sciences talking about very nice astronomical observations that their telescope is going to make. So I thank you all for attending this session, and all of this has been recorded and custom lived into YouTube, so you guys can go back and look at the talk again. Thank you again for joining. Thank you, Gopal, for arranging.
Thank you.
And thank you, Satya, for doing the YouTube
link. Yeah, thanks to Satya for the YouTube link.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you. Bye.